Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Hello, everybody, virtually and in body and in person. Welcome to, what is this? March 10th. Already. Welcome, welcome to the North St. Paul Maplewood Oakdale Rotary Club, where I have the honor of being this year's club president, where we meet locally to improve lives. No, what? I know, but we meet locally, virtually, I guess, and in person to improve lives locally and globally. There we go. Anyways, hey, everybody online. Welcome. Ken, Terry, would you be willing to help us with the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America
and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. And if we could have Barb lead us in the five-way test.
Sure. The five-way test of the things we think, say, and do. Number one.
Is it the truth?
Number two.
Is it fair to all concerned?
Number three.
Will it build goodwill and better friendships?
Number four.
Will it be beneficial to all concerned?
And number five.
Woo-hoo!
Is it fun?
Is it fun? Was everyone greeted this morning virtually, online, and in person? Awesome. Awesome. It's good to see you. I don't know if April, do you have an invocation or Adam has an invocation for us?
Un momento.
Oh, bilingüe.
Well, that's the limit of my Spanish. That's very much. So let me get back.
That's my thing. Do you have a microphone?
Do you have a microphone, Mike? I'm Adam.
So one of the things that gets to be a little frustrating is the idea of expectations, right? Like, for example, we often listen to the weather report and we expect a certain amount of snow, or we expect a certain kind of condition, right? And so sometimes one of the struggles we have is with unmet expectations, right? So today, as maybe as an invocation, just a thought that is based on the idea of hope from the scriptures. So there's little in life that brings us more frustration than unmet expectations. Yet, as a person of faith or people of faith, we're promised the possibility of a life of hope. But there's a very fine line between hope and expectations that can seem very blurry. So even the most commonly used dictionaries, there isn't much help between those words because they get used interchangeably. There's one small caveat when it comes to expectations and hopes. It often has to do with a prospect of an inheritance, something that we will acquire later. So one of our great challenges is to be people of hope. Almost to say as though a person can inherit something that they didn't even know they could have or earn just by our sharing of a hopeful future with other people. Of course, the picture of across scripture is that God offers hope. Jesus offers hope to people often. Our job is, for example, as myself as a pastor, is to offer that same hope for people. So maybe for you, the challenge is, how do I share hope with somebody else today so they can inherit a brighter future?
Hope for tomorrow. Thank you. Thank you very much,
thanks,
Adam.
Everyone.
All right. Well, thank you. And it's good to see everyone again. Couple announcements. We have happy hour this Wednesday, the 14th at the D Spot in Oakdale, known for their chicken wings. So if you like chicken wings, they're really, really good. And I believe the owner is a local guy too. I don't know if he went to North, but he's from Oakdale. So anyways, good chicken wings. So Wednesday at 6 o'clock.
My daughter used to work there and said it was the best job she ever had. The culture there was so welcoming and fun and warm.
I hope. I hope I get to see more, a lot of people. A lot, yeah. Yes.
When you're there, ask them for
a gift card.
Gift cards, because otherwise they're very hard to get gift cards out of, because I've tried two or three times.
Interesting that you say that, because we've got postcards that talk about our save the date for our clay shoot, and we have raffle tickets that have come in. So right there with you, Char, about now, it's never too early to start thinking about sponsors and teams and auction items and gift cards, as we are now starting to break out and go to different restaurants across the area. So, yes. Also, I want to recognize that Wednesday was International Women's Day. So, again, it's a time to honor the achievements of women around the world and raise awareness of the work that is still needed to achieve equality. So, I mean, it's we've got a long way to go, but we've come a long way too. So I just want to acknowledge all the women in our lives, our moms, our sisters, our girlfriends, our wives, our daughters, all that we have contributed to the greater good here. I also want to take this opportunity and ask Sylvia if she is ready to share about Sylvia's children in Uganda.
Now, and Sean, you've got a, I sent Sean a picture. What I did was, you went to Israel and I went over to Uganda, November 14th to the 17th. I have a group going, end of May, where it's not that one, Sean, I want the one of the kids. And what I wanted to do while I was there was take a picture of all of the orphans that you guys were the driving force on for the District 5960 grant. I mean, all of you helped. It was wonderful. So now 36 orphans are in high school. Their tuition is paid for the full year, food, clothing, lodging, healthcare, and education, thanks to the fact that you were the driving force on it. And I wanted to get a picture of those kids, because it's great to say, okay, yes, it's paid, you know, the kids are taken care of, but you need to see it. However, while I was there, what I also wanted to do was see what damage we had because of COVID. You don't know what the conditions were in Uganda, but the people were not allowed to out of their homes after 2 o'clock. No driving. There was no driving, no cars, no taxis, no boda-bodas, nothing. And so we were prohibited from just even going to the school and checking on it. So there, because you have these torrential downpours during the rainy season, we had roof damage in the library and the dorms. We also had lots of structural damage. So I saw that they have done most of those repairs. The key thing was to get the library fixed again. So I made sure that we can get the roof replaced on that. And then the other thing was, Sean has these pictures of the dorms. We lost the roof of one of the dorms. We have a boys' dorm and a girls' dorm. And all of our fire alarms are gone. So I came back with, okay, I need to get 20 fire alarms, the nets for the basketball hoops and the volleyball area. Those were all damaged. And of course, we kept the basketballs and we kept the volleyballs in the library. So they were damaged. This is to show you, this is the dorms. This is how these kids are. I'm hoping that he got the picture of the all of the kids, because I did send that earlier this week. But really,
he hasn't received it yet.
Pardon?
He did not receive it yet.
Oh, great. Well, best laid plans, right? I should have checked with you yesterday, Sean. What I will do is I'll send it to him again so that you'll be able to see these gorgeous kids and realize that you as a club and as individuals within the club helped make a difference. I have just the upcoming trip. I have 6 people now. It is the Platinum Jubilee, discovered 20 years as platinum, for Sylvia's children. So Jeffrey has pulled out all the African stops to create this event. So I'm afraid it'll be a little more commotion than what I usually like to do, which is just go over and work. But I'm very excited about that. And I already have 4 people committed for the Christmas trip, which will be mid-November. So keep that in mind if you want to spend Christmas with 1,000 beautiful children. I would love to have you join me. I'm grateful to you as a club. You are phenomenal. You continue to be the best. And it makes me cry when I can't be there. Thanks, Noemi, for letting me say something.
Sylvia, you are like our ambassador. You know, you are the extension of what we want to make an impact across the world. And you're the epitome of that, doing that. So we appreciate you and thrilled when you do come into town, to be here in person. And
you would laugh. I always go to the Masaka Rotary. Well, I'm like a long lost friend. Oh, Sylvia, you're back. I go twice a year. They make sure I get the little card, you know, that's proof that I showed up. And they make sure that I get my picture taken with the president. And we have cake tonight, Sylvia. Do you want to cut the cake? They're extraordinarily kind and loving and welcoming. It's Rotary around the world.
Mm-hmm.
Wonderful. Well, thank you, Sylvia, for sharing that with us.
Thank you.
Okay, well, now we are lucky to have our very own Don Martin from, I don't know where you're from, in the area,
Lionel Lakes.
Like next door?
Lionel Lakes.
Oh, Lionel Lakes, Lionel Lakes. To come talk to us about Feed My Starving Children. So you have about 25 minutes to talk to us.
Wow, well, that's going to take, you might get out early today. So first of all, thanks for the invitation, and thanks to Sylvia for her inspiration. About 6 or 7 years ago, I started working with a pastor in Liberia, partially because of the presentations at your club, and I hear about these people having schools, and I thought, well, how does that work? And over time, we've been able to open an elementary school and hopefully next year a high school in Liberia, right near the capital, Monrovia. So thanks to Sylvia and thanks to your club for your inspiration. It just keeps going on and on. But this morning I'm here to talk to you about Feed My Starving Children. And we're back on schedule. We're sort of in a post-COVID world now where we're going back to the mobile packs that we had previously. And at Incarnation Lutheran Church in Shoreview, where many of you, I suspect, have packed meals before, we're having a mobile pack there. And it's April 26th to 30th. And Nina has the details about when the packing shifts are. You can look at those and see when it, when it works for your club and for the local high schools. And I understand that this year the plan is to invite 3 different high schools in the area to participate with you, and that's fantastic to have your members come over and pack with the high school youth at the same time. So the goal this year is to pack 614,304 meals. That's enough to feed 1,683 kids for a year. That's 1 meal a day for a year. And so I wanted to thank you again for the past, you know, your past participation has been fantastic. All the energy and the just to see you working alongside, you know, multi-generational with the youth and the club. So I wanted to spend a little bit of time. So just to back up, have many of you participated in the mobile pack before, or do you want more information about that? Many of you have been to a mobile pack. Well, let me talk. I'll talk a little bit about Feed My Starving Children and how the mobile pack fits into the Feed My Starving Children overall picture. So, Feed My Starving Children is a Christian nonprofit organization. It was started in Minnesota at least 30 years ago now. And it was started by a gentleman who went to Central America, and he came back and he said, there's a lot of hungry kids down there. We need to send them some meals, send them some food. And they started sending surplus General Mills cereals and things, you know, foods like that, foods that were available, packaged meals that were available, sending them down to Central America. And it turns out it made the kids sick because of it wasn't really adapted to their diet. And it wasn't breakfast cereal isn't particularly nutritious for completely, you know, a balanced meal, 100%. So they worked with food scientists at General Mills in Pillsbury, and they came up with a nutritionally balanced meal, which they've been producing and then modifying over the years. And so it's got protein with soy protein. It's got carbohydrates with the rice. It's got a vitamin additive, and then it's got some dehydrated vegetables. So that was the beginning of Feed My Starving Children. And now this year, it'll be a record year. Again, it'll be over a million kids each day will receive a meal somewhere in the world through Feed My Starving Children. So what I'd like to do next is just talk a little bit about how the meals end up where they end up and how they start out. The ingredients are all produced in the United States. There's rice that's grown down and just grown in Arkansas and Texas, believe it or not. And there's soy protein from soybeans that's grown somewhere in the Midwest. And then the dried vegetables and there's potatoes and carrots and some other dried vegetables. And then there's a special vitamin, and they call that the secret sauce of the meals. It's got all the vitamin supplements that are required by the UN and other organizations. And they reformulate that periodically to match the latest research. And it's interesting. It turns out that food scientists are a lot like economists, and you try to nail them down to exactly what you should do, and everybody's got a slightly different answer. So you kind of have to average all the opinions and decide what you're going to do for your meals. So these meals are then packed. And in the past, the meals were packed 100% by volunteers. And it was like at a mobile pack or a permanent site. And at the, where you put the ingredients in one at a time in the bag, and then you seal the bag, and each bag has six meals in it. Each box has 36 bags of meals or 36 bags, which six meals each. And then those go onto a pallet, and you end up with thousands of meals on one pallet. And then those meals get shipped either to an emergency relief site, like a hurricane or a earthquake, or they get sent to schools and orphanages around the world. And the strategy of Feed My Starving Children is to be the provider of meals, but not work as a mission in each country, which would require a lot of spreading out of the effort. So they allow orphanages and schools and organizations to apply for grants for meals. And then they evaluate the grants, and those are the mission partners. Then if they're approved, then they become a mission partner, and then the meals are sent to that mission partner. And the strategy is that we won't give you a meal for this week and you have to wonder about next week. The strategy is to provide a school with meals, or provide a community or a school with meals, so they don't have to worry about where their next meal is coming from. And that relates back to that hope. Once you have your meals in place, you can start to think about your future. You can start to think about your schooling, what you might want to be when you grow up, because you're not just scraping around trying to find enough food for that particular day. So Feed My Starving Children works with these mission partners all over the world and distributes the food in that way. And I'm not sure who all the mission partners are. I know I've seen during the Afghanistan war, I saw pallets coming out of, not personally, but pictures of pallets coming out of U.S. Helicopters and being distributed to schools in remote places in Afghanistan. So it's not just, there are quite a few meals that are delivered by canoe or, you know, across sort of an odd path by mission partners, but there's a lot of other support as well to get the meals where they need to be. So Feed My Starving Children, they have a delivery rate of 99.6% of the meals they pack end up at the right location. And this is in locations like Uganda, like Liberia, like even places like North Korea, believe it or not, where these meals are delivered for these starving kids. So are there any questions about how Feed My Starving Children kind of operates, what the meals are like, or get a little more background on Feed My Starving Children?
How do you ship them? How do you ship these meals?
The meals leave Minnesota typically by truck, and then they end up on one of the coasts. The way Feed My Starving Children is structured, there's permanent packing sites in Minnesota. There's three. There's one in Phoenix, Arizona. There's one in Dallas, Texas, and there's three in the Chicago area. And for example, the site in Arizona, most of those meals go to the West Coast and end up in Asia. Most of the meals in Minneapolis, they'll either go east to get on a ship to go towards Africa, or they'll go south to a ship to go towards Central America or Haiti in that area, or South America. And I would guess the ones in Europe go to the East Coast as well, over to Ukraine.
You get special rates from the shippers because you're a 501c3?
Well, that's an interesting situation, because it's on the Feed My Starving Children. They do the meals, they pack the meals, they provide them, and it's up to the mission partner to provide the shipping costs.
Ah, okay. So that's more of a pull from the mission group.
Right. It shows commitment by the mission group. And that really helps get that 99.6% delivery rate, because they've got some skin in the game. Somebody's got some skin in the game.
No. I know. That's why I asked the question.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because if everything is provided, there is no skin in the game. So it's
right. Easy. Right. So that's been a really good, and it really builds a strong partnership. It Feed My Starving Children has some, I'm going to call it leverage on the situation. For example, when I met the school I'm working with in Liberia, Pastor Sylvester, he said, well, I want to start a school because there's kids on the street and it's not really safe for them to be out on the street all day. So I'd like to start a school with my church, and I need meals. So I said I went to Feed My Starving Children. I said, well, you know, we got this situation, and this is what it is. He wants to start a school. He needs some meals. And they said, well, we have partners already in Liberia. We'll arrange for them to share some of their meals with Pastor Sylvester to help him get started. So they shipped a pallet of meals over. So we had meals. And if you're in a poor neighborhood, meals attract kids like you know what. And so they were able to get the kids in off the street and give them nutritious meals at the same time. And it was because of the partners they already had there and the relationship they have with the partners.
And were they able to start a school?
Pardon me?
Was he able to start
a school? Yeah, he started a school. Yeah, that's the school I talked about a few minutes ago, where the elementary school building was finished last year, and hopefully the high school building will be finished this year, high school classrooms. So it's pretty amazing. And since then, he's found other sources of meals, because he's not... takes a while to get in line and get approved to be a Feed My Starving Children partner. But the relationship is with Feed My Starving Children with mission partners, and the mission partners take care of getting the food and then distributing it within their organization. And they've done, like in Liberia, where there's a dozen partners or so, just small churches, small orphanages. They have some cooperative agreements where they share warehouse space and they share some costs that way. But that requires some trust between the partners if you're going to put your meals in with somebody else's meals.
Yep.
They're trying to build trust and they build accountability, and everybody has some skin in the game, and it works. This works amazingly well, what they're able to do.
I noticed that they have a spokesman now for Feed My Children. Can you speak to that? Is that something new, or
a spokesman?
Oh, yeah, there's an advertisement on TV, Feed My Children, and Help Me Feed the Children. And it's one of the actors. I can't remember his name, but it's one of the. Have you seen that ad?
Sure. Feed My Children or Feed My Starving Children?
Well, I think it's Feed My Starving. Well, that's it. I am not sure which one he's doing.
Yeah.
Feed My Children or Feed My Starving Children. Yeah.
Your first thing was you said Feed My Children, which says to me there may be
a different group.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, there's a lot of variations, and a lot of the meals look similar. They're in the same size little plastic, sealed bag. And it's you know, it's great to feed kids however you can do it, but everybody has a little different approach. And I'm not aware of Feed My Starving Children having any actors signed up yet, any celebrities. Okay,
so it's probably a different organization.
It could be. Yeah, it's confusing. Yeah, Pastor Sylvester has sent me pictures of boxes, and he says, look, here we have some more Feed My Starving Children meals. And on the box, it has a picture and has a name of a different organization. So it's a different organization.
John, I've got a question for you. You mentioned that Feed My Starving Children is started in Central America. And many of the countries you just mentioned are either East African or Central African or North African countries. How was the determination made where the food goes? Is that made through Feed My Starving Children, or is that made through the ministry partners that distribute the food, or is that in conjunction with like the UN or those kinds of organizations to determine where the food goes?
Well, yeah, that's a really good question. I know that I don't know the right word for it, but there's an allocation committee at Feed My Starving Children, and they meet each year and review applications, and then they decide who's going to get how many meals. And it's more or less on the basis of is the organization's last year, how have their requirements changed? Is, you know, one criteria, because you want to feed the children all the way through school. You don't want them to be dodging around looking for meals. So that's the one criteria. But it starts out within Feed My Starving Children. They decide. But once they give it to the partner, so that's the one side of it, that once they give it to the partner, it's up to the partner to distribute it. So if they work with a partner who ships food to East Africa and West Africa, and there happens to be a famine in East Africa, they may shift some of that food from West Africa to East Africa, at least temporarily. So it's kind of but it goes to the partner, and then the partner decides, and it depends how big the partner is. That's kind of the way it works. They work with UN. They serve meals in refugee camps and other, you know, other organizations, other places around the world.
Any of the food going in the United States?
You know, at one time there was some going to the United States, but there doesn't seem to be the demand. You see very few malnourished, starving children with their hair, you know, turning orange and falling out in the distended bellies. You just don't see that. And this is really food for the least of these.
I have a question as well. Wondering about, do you ever know? I mean, I've packed many, many, many meals through Feed My Starving Children. And I wonder often, like, I try to picture the kids sitting down and eating this. Do you ever get feedback on what it tastes like or what they think of it? I know when you're starving, you're happy to have food and nutrition, but I was just curious if there's ever any conversations on the end by the end users about that at all and what the feedback they provide. It's an interesting question. I like picturing who's eating it and what they think of it when they are.
Along that line was like the profile, the like Latin America is like beans and rice. And
yeah.
I'm sure like in Asia, there might be like seaweed or soy or different kinds of profiles.
Right, 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 right. Of what people like to eat. But I know in packing it, it's a lot of beans and rice and powder.
Yeah.
Beans and rice are usually a lot of their staple.
Yeah, exactly. I'm sure. And I don't know. I was always curious if it gets rehydrated into like a soup or more like a stew, or I guess I'm just trying to picture the end of it.
Yeah. The way it works is that they it is the main component is rice, and everybody knows across the world knows about rice. And so they're comfortable with that. And you make it into a, it's similar, what I would call it to a rice-a-roni.
Oh, yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
You make a box of rice roni, except it, instead of just the filler or the flavoring, it's got the soy protein in it. So it's very nutritionally good. And if you go to a permanent site, actually, if you come to the mobile pack this time, you'll be able to taste it. We'll have samples.
Yeah, I've been to the permanent site too, but I've never done the tasting of it. So I just thought that was interesting.
it's a post-COVID dare, you know. Are you going to go get that little thing and taste it or not? But yeah, the kids do like it. I've heard, in fact, Pastor Sylvester, when I went, we were just over there in February to see him. And first time I'd been over there. And he said, you know, the kids really like these meals. They're really good.
Oh, I bet they do. I mean, it sounds, and they actually, when I look at them, they look good. I'm just always curious.
Yeah. And the other thing that they do is they'll add to the meals with local vegetables. You know, they'll chop up like sweet potato greens or whatever and put in with the stew or with
That makes sense. That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah. So they get fresh ingredients when they can.
Yeah. I assume that when they develop this, that they balance, because like soy is deficient in lysine. And usually when you feed pigs, you put corn and soy together to make it a complete amino acid balance. So I'm assuming that that's my animal science background coming.
There you go.
So I'm wondering how they balance the amino acid balance in that feed my kids.
Well, you just went way over my head, Char.
Okay. Sorry.
I'm guessing there's a lot of food scientists involved in developing that.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah. In the beginning stages, I guess.
There is. And I know with this particular meal, with Feed My Starving Children meals, that is one of the main concerns. It's not starving only, it's malnutrition. It's solving the malnutrition problem. And so it must be in with I would guess it's some of that vitamin additive that goes in. It must have some additional additives, because it's billed and accepted as a fully balanced meal by the UN relief agencies and those kinds of groups. It's they're really serious about it. It's pretty interesting to hear some of those discussions about the actual content of the meal. But it's over my head.
Sorry about that.
Oh no, that's fine. That's fine. That's good.
Do they ever partner with like the bigger organizations like Red Cross or UNICEF or like the UN relief?
They participate in for disaster relief.
Yeah.
But like, for example, when the hurricane comes in and demolishes, or the earthquake came into Haiti, for example, many of those organizations were gone as soon as sort of the press kind of stopped, maybe a little longer. Feed My Starving Children was there before and they're there after. So they have a hard time, and they don't really, I know they don't partner with the Red Cross. I might be serving people who also get the Red Cross tarps, but they're not working directly with Red Cross. It's a different timeline, I think, primarily. But they'll work with the UN in refugee camps, you know. So if their partners are working in the refugee camp, they'll work through their partners.
So it's directly through partnerships like churches or ministries.
Churches or in other non-government organizations, yeah. Like for example, in Haiti, with you know the whole disintegration of the government in Haiti, they had an outbreak of cholera in Haiti, and Feed My Starving Children has a product or a meal called Manipak D, which the D is for diarrhea, so Manipak D, and it's got potato. It's a potato based meal that helps solve the everything just running right through you and allows your body to absorb some nutrients. So there was quite a number of pallets that were sent to Haiti by air, delivered by air, to get them into the country to help stem the cholera upcoming epidemic that was developing. So they have a lot of connections, you know, on the ground with these different mission partners, and so they can respond pretty directly to specific problems.
That's awesome.
Mark,
So
the special formula for when they and they said it was like 100%. It was like unbelievably high percentage of the kids that survived because they got that special formula. It was really the numbers were staggeringly high.
Yeah.
How effective it was.
Yeah, it's like the best. It's interesting because you can have, I suppose you can have drugs to treat cholera, but at some point you need to get some nutrition into the body again. And this particular formulation, and it was developed with the, believe it or not, the Idaho Potato Farmers Organization sponsored that development to develop this. So there's a Manipak D, and then there's a Manipak W for weaning for small young children. So when they go off of breastfeeding, they get this other formula, and it's very powerful. It's just what they need nutritionally. So yeah, I think that's the three formulations they have. So if there's, did I use up my 25 minutes yet, or can I keep going?
I mean, what an opportunity.
What I'd like to do is just, if there's no other questions right now, I'd just like to wrap up with a little bit of post-COVID, what happened through COVID, and then where the organization is headed now. That's all right.
Sure. Yes.
Okay. I'll go through that pretty quickly. So as your club knows, you know, about a lot of the meals, in fact, almost a quarter of the meals are packed at mobile packs. And 100% of the meals were packed by volunteers. And then when COVID came, you couldn't have any volunteers come into the facilities, and you couldn't have any mobile packs going. So the whole food packaging, whole food packing, it shut down within, you know, whenever the magic day came and they said, well, we're shutting down, they shut down. And within 2 weeks, they had, 2 or 3 weeks, they had their suppliers and others mixing the meals and packaging them into bags, and they were shipping again. It took a while through COVID to ramp it up, but until that day, every meal had been packed by volunteers, and that was a big part of the organization. It's volunteer driven. So that's one change that came about through COVID, is they had some subcontractors that mixed the meals and then packaged them. And also as a part of COVID, there was an organization that provided machinery to one of the food processors. And they said, well, we'd like to build you a packaging machine to take the raw materials, mix them and bag them and put them on pallets. And so those are probably the two changes that have happened as far as the food production, is now there's a single line, if you want to call it production line, in Eagan, Minnesota, that it's manually driven. They load the ingredients in, and then they get mixed, and then they kind of, you know, they help it along through the line. But they'll do 30,000 meals a day on that line when they're running it. And it gives them some flexibility as far as disaster response. If they need a lot more meals in one particular place at a time, it gives them as Mark Correa, the CEO, says, it gives them another lever to pull or push to change production and respond. And now they have subcontractors that are at least familiar with the processes, whether they use them or not right now, I'm not sure, to add additional capacity. So that was one thing that COVID changed, was from all volunteer pack to now mostly volunteer pack. And the rapid response during COVID was pretty amazing to see. So now we're post-COVID, and their mobile pack group went from probably 120 people down to 11 people. And because there was no meals to be packed anymore. There was no mobile packs allowed anywhere, and they had these people that travel around the country and set up these mobile packs. So now they're in the process of rebuilding their mobile pack crew, which is going well. But it's, as anybody in business knows, it's a challenge to find employees right now. So volunteers are still out there, I guess, but the employees to actually know to set it up and get it going, a little bit of a challenge. But in the year now after COVID, the first full year that they operated, they've set new records with the number of meals packed and shipped. So that they're back. It's stronger than ever. A little more, a few bumps have healed, and they're charging ahead. It's good. We worked with them at Incarnation. We had a couple of mobile packs that were, how do you do this in COVID kind of a mobile pack. And then by the time that process was all worked out, then it changed, of course. And now it's like, well, we're after COVID now. So it's, but it's continues to be a strong organization. They've had 5 out of 5 stars for the past 10, 11, 12 years with Charity Navigator. They're a very dedicated group. They pray over every meal that goes out. They're very very faithful in what they do. Very faith based. So, there's any other questions? Or I really look forward to your crew being there at the mobile pack. It's always a fun shift when you guys come and pack meals.
Well, I mean, what an opportunity to come together, you know, and do something good. And the mobile pack is actually going to be, so mark your calendars, Wednesday, April 26th through Sunday, April 30th. There are 2-hour commitments, a 2-hour shift commitment. So if we can get a group of us, like all of us, to do it together, because that's part of having fun together and giving back to our local and global communities. So there's different shifts. What I can do is send this out to the club so you can look at it and we can talk it up and let's do it together. And if we can't together, we can do it separate, but still together in spirit, because, you know, we can make a difference when we join Incarnation and the surrounding communities. And there's a scan and all sorts of stuff. So Don, this is absolutely incredible to think that, you know, the power of coming together is what it's about.
Yeah.
Uniting and taking action.
Yeah.
I will say you can bring friends too. I brought my kids and it was pre-COVID, so they must have only been 8 years old, but they still talk about it and they loved the experience. So it doesn't have to be just Rotarians. Bring your extended family.
Family affair for sure. And they have the gloves and net heads and everything. So it's all hygienic and super, super awesome. I've been to the one in Egan and they have a video of how far and wide the impact. So thank you. Gideon has a question.
They are. Sorry.
Oh, here we go. Look at this.
Those are the kids that you helped sponsor.
What grades are these kids?
It's S1, secondary one, or S2, secondary. So it's, you know, it's because it's based on the British model. S1 is sort of like 8, 9 in there. So these kids would be, because there's no demanding age that kids start school, they could be anywhere from 12 to 16 years old. And the red uniforms means that we haven't yet gotten them in their regular uniforms. So those I know are S1s.
Look at that student in the middle. She blends right in.
Yeah, that old lady. Well, you know, it was so cute because they say, here comes our granny. Considering that I've known a lot of these kids, some of them since they were 2, 3, 4 years old, I am their granny.
Yep.
Really cool, Sylvia.
Beautiful. Thank you so much for sharing that with us. Our guest from Roseville, Gideon, you had an announcement you'd like to make. Can you give him the microphone? Can you use the microphone? Thank you.
Thank you. I do have some flyers here to pass around. Another community event that would like to invite you to, and it's called the Sunrise, as you'll see. This is what the St. Paul Sunrise Club did 17 years ago when they came up with the forum. In the past, they have taken on policing, and the chief police, Arredondo from Minneapolis, was part of that, of the panel. They took on better Better and Brave Angels, and Bill Doughty was on the panel. They took on prisons, and they, you know, they had the Commissioner of Corrections sue on the panel. And then you remember they took on the racial disparity, and Jose Johnson was on the panel. These forums are so good that, you know, as soon as I hear of them, I want to sign up even before I know the topic. So this year, it's about kids, schools, and mental health. And I encourage you to plan attending. That's all I wanted to say.
Thank you, Gideon. Thank you. Thank you. As you can see, opportunities to share our opinions about things that are impacting us here locally. Together, we see a world where people unite and take action to create lasting change across the globe, in our communities, and in ourselves. Why? So that we can increase our impact, expand our reach, enhance participant engagement, and increase our ability to adapt. If we've learned about adaptation, it's through COVID. You modify and adjust daily. So, okay, here's a cheesy one for you to send you off. I see everybody's like sitting at the edge of their chair. Why can you never gossip in a cornfield? Too many ears. Yeah. There you go. Everybody have a wonderful week.
Thank you, Sylvia. Thank you, Don.
Thank you.
Thank you for bringing breakfast.